In your paper, you talk about this paradigm shift and the problem of the opacity of generative AI models. That actually took me back to the original way we assess AI using the Turing test. How do you feel about that? How much does that still apply or not apply in this new paradigm?
Yeah, the Turing test was to evaluate whether an AI system is actually an AI or human, or similar to human. And it is testing a black box by interacting with it. And that's pretty much what we do with Gen AI today as well. It is a black box, and we are interacting with it and try to evaluate how well it's doing. But that's the crucial difference. If the Gen AI acts like a human, that's just a side effect. We're actually trying to get it to solve tasks, do something useful. So the evaluations may be evaluating a black box, but it's actually towards a purpose.
What AI-related approaches of the past that pertain to the development, understanding, and deployment of AI do not carry over in this new paradigm?
Well, for a long time, we were using statistics, and that's a really good tool. And we could train, say, an AI system multiple times and try to estimate how well it would do in the future when it's put out there in the world where we don't control it anymore. It's on its own. But that's unfortunately really not possible anymore with Gen AI because training these systems is so intense that we can only do it once. Even if we try to repeat it, it would be a different kind of technique, different kind of data. So we cannot really do this kind of statistical testing. And instead, we need to take tools from, say, social science, where we have a sample of one or a very small sample, and we may do interviews, we may do ratings, and that is actually the core of the paradigm set.
Right, and in your article, you actually talk about being inspired by neuroscience, which made me wonder, how do we know if a neuroscience-inspired technique actually does apply to generative AI or not?
Well, it's hard to know ahead of time, but and also it's really an analogy that in brain science, neuroscience, we are looking at a really complex, large system, and we have only simple probes to it, partial views of it, and we try to construct an understanding of that complex system. And that's precisely what we do in generative AI as well. So the tools might apply, but we have to try them to see if they actually do.
Okay, by the same token, how do we bring in metacognition? You do talk about that in the article as well. How do we bring those techniques in?
Well, metacognition is something we can already build if we, say, have two of those LLMs to talk to each other. One of them might, for instance, give a commentary of what the first one is doing, and in that sense, try to be metacognitive. But that's really just an engineering approach. What would be really great is to have the system learn to be metacognitive on its own. And I don't know exactly how to do it. That's a challenge for the future. But one hint is that we still have a couple of orders of magnitude to go before we reach the numbers of parameters in the brain. Maybe if we scale up some more, some of those systems might actually emerge, metacognitive systems. They probably need some encouragement. We still might have secondary objectives for those LLMs, or maybe fine-tuning that allows them to emerge. But it is the right way of doing it. So we'll have a system that actually evaluates itself and can correct itself and expand on its reasoning. So that, I think, is the next step in generative AI.
Given the paradigm shift and your suggestions, how should, like from a practical perspective, how should enterprises and businesses think about this?
The generative AI is no longer really a calculator that you can completely trust and box, know what it's doing, how to interface with it. It's much more like a human expert. And enterprises already have mechanisms for incorporating expertise into their workflow. People are trained, reskilled. Sometimes you ask for outside consultants to come in and provide expertise. And that kind of structure probably is more appropriate than the calculator approach, that you are dealing with systems that are quite knowledgeable, but they need a lot of hand-holding, a lot of assessment. And building on those systems that are done now on human experts probably can be adapted to taking advantage of AI as well.
Those were some great insights, Risto. Thank you.
Thank you, Babak.